in the disaster. The messages told them their loved ones were dead. The 40-year-old was arrested and his computer equipment seized. The police say the Foreign Office would not contact people about a bereavement by email. Detectives are renewing their appeals for help in finding a woman who's seriously ill and hasn't been seen for a week. Avril Findon went missing from her home at Watnall near Nottingham on Boxing Day. She's 58 years old, 5'7", with short grey hair. She may be unsteady on her feet as she's being treated for cancer. School nurses will soon be able to prescribe special exercise courses to children who are overweight. It's part of a two-year experiment which will start later this month in Nottingham. The aim is to combat obesity by building self-esteem, promoting healthy eating and getting youngsters more active.
Children like Ramsey benefited from the Go For It courses when they were tried out for a few weeks last year. The 9-year-old changed his eating habits and took up exercise and noticed the difference.
I used to have big cheeks, now I've got little cheeks. And I used to have big neck, now I've got a little neck.
The Nottingham paediatrician behind the idea had to stop the courses because funding ran out. Now there's enough public money to run the sessions for 2 years.
Weight control seemed to be difficult. You might start, but you can never really control your weight. And the good thing that we're trying to do is have a fun-based programme, so the emphasis is on fun.
That's a goalie's ball!
School nurses in Nottingham will refer children to the courses at local leisure centres, and experts at the Nottingham University will monitor the results. Rob Sissons, East Midlands Today.
The Leicester Tigers have been in action this afternoon. The Zurich Premiership leaders have been away at Gloucester. They've stretched their unbeaten record, the final score 13-28. Let's have a look at the weather now. Cloudy tonight with a chance of a shower. Temperatures down to 3 degrees Celsius. Mainly dry tomorrow with sunny spells. Temperatures up to 10 degrees Celsius, but feeling fresh in the gusty wind. That's it from the weekend team. I'll be back tomorrow morning at 6:30.
Riz Perry stays a month with a tribe tomorrow at 9 on BBC Two.
Hello there. Northern Scotland has had blizzards through the day today. The snow is now clearing, but we're all continue to see very strong winds through much of the week ahead. The wind's particularly strong on Monday night and into Tuesday morning, and then again on Wednesday. Severe gales are likely, particularly across northern Britain, so something of a stormy week lying ahead. Those winds could certainly cause some problems. They're certainly expected to bring spells of rain across the country, but for most of us it will be a little bit milder over the coming days, certainly compared to today. Northern Britain today struggling at 3 or 4 Celsius for many areas. Tomorrow most of us up to about 9 or 10 Celsius, so Monday should be a little bit milder. It's pretty chilly out there at the moment though, temperatures falling away in the clear sky, so there could be some ice around on untreated surfaces for a time through the evening across England and Scotland. It shouldn't be a problem though by the morning, things turning milder as the night goes on, and it won't be snow, it'll be rain coming into northwestern Scotland for the morning. Maybe a little bit of rain for Northern Ireland for a time, but I think much of Northern Ireland and certainly most of England and Wales having a dry day tomorrow. Maybe just one or two scattered showers in western areas. It'll be in the east where we see the best of the spells of sunshine. Not too much sunshine though across Scotland. Cloudy skies here and always across the north and the west outbreaks of rain. The wind's picking up again through tomorrow, and it's really tomorrow night across northern Britain when we are quite concerned about the strength of the wind. Severe gales likely. That wet and windy weather then sweeping south across England and Wales through the course of Tuesday, turning a bit brighter across the north. Good evening.
I want us to buy Silverdale.
Are you on drugs in here?
I was put on this case to watch your back. I would appreciate some cooperation.
BBC One with a new series of Down to Earth, next.
Starspell, 5 celebrities get tongue-tied.
Can I start again?
Richard Whiteley, Joe Brand, Jeremy Bowen, Penny Smith and Dick from Dick and Dom. Only one of them will become Britain's best celebrity speller.
Comedian, Flibbity Gibbets.
I know that's wrong already.
Flatulent.
Starspell, tomorrow at 6 on BBC One.
Now on BBC One, Dermot Murnaghan with a specially extended BBC News.
1 week after the earthquake disaster, the biggest aid effort the world has ever seen. 5 million are homeless. Many families are at risk from waterborne diseases. In Sri Lanka, supplies begin to get through in spite of heavy flooding. And here, prayers are said across the country as the British death toll rises. Good evening. Food parcels and medical supplies are finally getting through to areas devastated by the tsunami disaster, but the pressure is on to speed up the distribution of aid to remote areas. According to the United Nations, about 1.8 million people are short of food and about 5 million are homeless. Clean water and sanitation are urgent priorities. 1 week on, we'll be assessing the picture across the region. Jeremy Bowen has the latest from eastern Sri Lanka. Jonathan Charles reports from the isolated Andaman Islands. And Kylie Morris is in Thailand's worst hit region. But we begin tonight with Indonesia, where 80,000 people have died and a million more are homeless. In a moment, Ben Brown on the first British aid to arrive in the country. But first, Andrew Harding in the northern town of Banda Aceh, which was closest to the scene of last Sunday's earthquake.
Scrubbed off the map, a little town called Chelang. Two-thirds of the population dead. And the survivors in a shocking state. We flew in with a team of doctors to a place that's been cut off from the outside world. Infections are spreading fast here. And there are week-old wounds to stitch.
The situation's really bad here. We're going to need a lot more drugs and equipment fast. The infections have got to a serious stage.
Rosmiati's two-year-old is getting weaker by the day.
He got the diarrhea.
Diarrhea.
What do you think will happen here now? What will you do now?
I don't know, she says. I don't know what to do. Everyone else in the family is dead. Down by the shoreline, I found some new arrivals. Survivors who just walked 20 miles to this ruined town, hoping to find help. So far, it's still scarce. This is what we live on, said Supriyadi.
So this is the only water you have?
Yes, he said, milk from the coconuts. And now, some rice to eat. That rice has just started arriving here, brought in by helicopter in fits and starts. It's a lifeline which many thousands of families are now utterly dependent on.
So a little aid is finally getting through to towns like Chelang. Here comes another helicopter with more. It's just about enough to keep the survivors alive. But still, you've got to wonder, what on earth is going to happen to places like this in the future? Is anyone really ever going to live here again?
Already the few who can are leaving here fast. This afternoon, 14-year-old Ria was flown away, perhaps for good. The wave broke her arm and wiped out her entire family. One victim rescued, but thousands more left behind. Andrew Harding, BBC News, Chelang, Indonesia.
Banda Aceh's little airport has suddenly become the hub for what is the biggest aid operation in history. Even so, it's still not enough and not fast enough. In fact, sometimes box loads of relief supplies sit on the way for hours at a time, and the pace of this airlift can seem frustratingly slow. The planes that bring aid in take out injured survivors of the disaster and some of those made homeless. These people know that without more aid, more quickly, The tsunami could yet claim new victims through the outbreak of diseases like typhoid and cholera. Tonight, the first plane load of British government relief supplies arrived here in Aceh. Some 50 tons of them. The RAF had to use the largest plane it has, a C-17. On board, food, water and heavy lifting gear donated by both the United Kingdom and Scandinavian countries who've lost so many of their people to the tsunami disaster. For the RAF crew, this was one of the most rewarding missions of their lives.
We feel very proud of our contribution today. We're certainly, as the Royal Air Force, very keen to get involved in the relief effort. We've brought about 50 tons of aid in today, and we hope to be now starting a continuous program of aid into the region.
Getting aid like this into the airport here is only half the story. Now it has to be distributed to the people who need it, and very fast indeed. But there are plenty of obstacles, long distances, impassable roads, fuel shortages and bureaucratic delays. Ben Brown, BBC News, Bandar Aceh Airport.
Well, earlier I spoke to Andrew Harding in Aceh and I asked him if the relief effort was beginning to have an impact.
It is. It hasn't reached full speed or anywhere like it yet. There are still huge logistical problems, problems of coordinating all these many, many different countries and agencies that are beginning to get their feet on the ground here. But yes, you look around here, you see an awful lot more aid workers. You hear the helicopters overhead, the cargo planes flying in all the time. So yes, a feeling that after a long, long week and a lot of impatient people getting tireder and hungrier, things are beginning to change.
And Andrew, you've been travelling across the region, meeting people, talking to them. What are their priorities in terms of aid?
The first priority is drinking water, pure and simple. It's very, very hot here. Food also a big problem. A lot of people surviving on packets of dried noodles, if they're lucky. Medical aid as well, a big, big challenge. There are a few drugs and a few doctors going round to these remote communities, but still an awful lot of people not getting attended to. Then there is the grisly problem, I'm afraid, still of corpses. There are an awful lot still around me here in the city, many thousands. There is a big push now to try and bury them, but it hasn't finished by a long way.
Andrew Harding, thank you. Well, the death toll from the disaster is now nearly 130,000. The Foreign Office has said the number of British people who've died has risen to 40. In Sri Lanka, the aid effort has been hampered by torrential rain. From Kalmunai in the east of the island, Jeremy Bowen has sent us this report.
It's easy to find the bodies the cleanup squads missed. You use your nose. More than 7,000 bodies have been found here around Kalmunai on Sri Lanka's east coast. On the beach, the body of a boy of around 10 had just been washed up. Alakaya Sutukumar took charge. He buries every corpse he finds, around 450 so far, because he's looking for 21 members of his family. He hasn't found one of them. The people here, though, can't spend their time grieving. The monsoon rains have virtually cut them off from the rest of Sri Lanka. Water is still the enemy. This devastated area that goes on for mile after mile along the Sri Lankan coast is now a massive health hazard. And it's not just dead bodies, though judging by the smell, there are still a few around here. It's all this filthy standing water. According to UNICEF, the biggest threat to life in Sri Lanka now are waterborne diseases. But they're not waiting for foreign experts to solve their problems. Local people have been mobilized to clean up their own streets. The organization in this camp comes from Tamil Tiger separatists, normally undercover in this government-controlled area, but operating here with official permission. They don't have enough clean water. 6,000 homeless people are in the camp without a single lavatory. If they get ill, they can't come to this hospital anymore. It was on the beach. The clock stopped at the moment the tsunami struck 1 week ago. Sometimes the pain breaks through. Abdulhamid Ramis was doing well until he saw relief supplies for families arriving. His wife and three children are dead. Almost all the aid in this part of Sri Lanka has been brought in by private citizens. They've moved much faster than the government. It means that there's food for people who've lost everything. Only the Air Force can reach the most isolated areas, but they haven't got many helicopters and they can't fly in rainstorms. People here need so much. Not just food and clean water and medical aid, but long-term investment to rebuild their destroyed communities, which will be the biggest challenge of all. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, on the east coast of Sri Lanka.
Well, I've been speaking to our correspondent John Sopel about the aid effort in Sri Lanka, and earlier he told us about the situation in the south of the country.
Here in Gaul, it's easier to count the number of houses that have been left standing by the tsunami rather than those which have been destroyed like this one. It's now estimated that there is something like 1 million people who've been made homeless by the tsunami. That represents a staggering 5% of the population, and that presents a massive humanitarian problem. They are staying in camps where there's inadequate sanitation, inadequate food supplies, inadequate medical supplies. Now, the government says it has enough equipment to get to the people who need it. The problem is the distribution network, making sure that those who are in the greatest need get the supplies and get the supplies quickly. We saw a food lorry arrive here on the main road a little earlier today, and there were scenes of near chaos. People queuing, people having to be kept under control as they waited for a bag of rice, a bag of sugar, or a bag of dal. The government says they will be able to avoid the outbreak of disease like cholera and typhoid and malaria, but they need to act, and act very quickly indeed.
John Sopel speaking earlier. Well, there's been growing concern about the fate of islands far out into the Indian Ocean, which rescuers have been unable to reach until now. On Nicobar alone, close to the epicentre of the earthquake, at least 10,000 people are still unaccounted for. Our correspondent Jonathan Charles is one of the first people to report from Car Nicobar since the earthquake struck.
Dead body, dead body.
Yet another body is located, yet another name to add to the long list of the dead. Car Nicobar Air Base was once the pride of the Indian military. Now it's nothing but rubble. More than 100 airmen and their families were killed here as first the earthquake and then the surging sea took their toll. The runway is barely serviceable, but it's been patched up. Now the Indian Air Force is managing to land food and water, desperately needed by the survivors on this island.
The Air Force base was washed away. So it was very difficult, and in the present circumstances, what they did, it is commendable.
But for Malacca village, it's too late for aid. As the water came through here, it met little resistance. Only a shrine to Mahatma Gandhi is still standing. Villagers from here are amongst the 10,000 islanders, thought to be either missing or dead.
The highest point on this island is just 12 metres above sea level. When the water came ashore here, there was nowhere to run to. That's why so many people lost their lives.
Those who did survive are deeply traumatised. Saira spends all day going from camp to camp, searching for her three missing children. She says she's most worried about her two-year-old son and hopes he's being looked after somewhere. But not even neighbours from her village are optimistic. This island's mental scars match its physical ones. Jonathan Charles, BBC News, Car Nicobar.
In Thailand, where thousands of holidaymakers are among the dead and the missing, relatives are still arriving from around the world to search for their loved ones. International forensic teams are also there to help identify the dead. Kylie Morris reports from the beach resort of Khao Lak.
The search continues. Families scan the death photos and check the lists for the names of their loved ones. Julian Mackenzie Charrington has arrived from London to look for his brother and take home his sister-in-law who was injured.
It became more and more obvious through what I was being told by people out here that the likelihood of finding my brother was going to be remote and that I shouldn't, in a sense, be concentrating on that too much and that I should be getting her home as soon as possible. And I really needed to find out what is going on here and how this has happened.
He goes to Khao Lak, where Nicholas was last seen, among a group of 20, mostly British, tourists. The wave virtually shredded the resort where they'd stayed. Julian tries to piece together what happened that day.
Where was your brother and his wife coming from?
Well, as I understand it, they were coming along from breakfast. As they approached what I believe to be their chalet there, is when the first panics started to happen.
Julian tells me the couple was separated by the force of the water. He admits that seeing the scene firsthand has helped.
I was just imagining bamboo huts. I'm not imagining really properly built buildings. A huge, this place has been absolutely torn to pieces. It's just beyond belief.
Julian says he'll return. In the meantime, he'll hope and pray his brother's body is found. Kylie Morris, BBC News, Khao Lak.
More than £1 billion in aid has now been pledged by governments and individuals across the world. Here, public donations have topped £60 million. Our developing world correspondent David Loin looks at how the aid agencies are making sure the money gets to where it's most needed and quickly.
A week on and aid is on its way from Britain. It's an emotional time for workers who've given up their Christmas holiday.
Absolutely fantastic. It's a week of hard work for the emergencies team. We've seen all the pictures, we've heard everything, now we're finally getting some aid up in the air and where it matters on the ground in Sri Lanka.
How much would you like to donate?
An unprecedented disaster matched by unprecedented giving. Central administration takes one penny in the pound, with costs at the agencies around 5 pence, leaving 94 pence in every pound for victims.
We have a historical percentage allocation of the total fund. The members already know, and the largest ones like Oxfam will get 20%, specialist agencies like Merlin 3%. So they know right from the beginning, they communicate effectively with their local staff who can then get on with the job.
The agencies negotiate with each other to avoid duplication on the ground, with some filling specialised roles. Oxfam, for example, are very good at providing clean water, while Merlin provide medical help. But getting aid out to the more remote places needs military assistance. Now, as well as two British warships, two French ships, including a helicopter carrier, are on their way from North Africa. The Indian Navy, the largest in the region, has been working in India and Sri Lanka, and Pakistan is sending a warship to Indonesia, while Singapore has offered its airfields and helicopters. But none of these has the capacity of the US fleet, whose helicopters are already helping Indonesia. The aircraft carrier USS Lincoln is leading the American military support, and even UN critics who had implied that America was trying to take over the aid effort are grateful now.
Those helicopters are worth their weight in gold now for us, because we have very good pledges, but it takes time to convert a pledge into assistance. But a helicopter can reach communities in no time.
But the 5 million people whose lives remain at risk need a coordinated effort on the ground, and that is just beginning. David Loin, BBC News.
Well, here the Deputy Prime Minister John Prescott has said Britain would consider sending more military help to the region if it's needed. The government has already promised £50 million worth of aid, but today the Conservative leader Michael Howard said it should be ready to match the amount given by the public. Jonathan Beale reports.
With Tony Blair away, John Prescott's been coordinating the government's response. They've been in constant touch, but have still to decide whether to send British troops to help in the relief operation.
We agreed that we'd send out further military liaison. We did send somebody out on the first day on the military side to look at that. Now we've sent a team out. We've agreed to send the two ships, of course, and aircraft involved as well. And we're looking now as to whether we might do more.
Troops from countries closer to the disaster are already on the ground. Britain has now sent two small reconnaissance teams to Sri Lanka and Indonesia, so more could follow. The Conservatives have questioned the Prime Minister's decision to oversee the government's response while abroad, but there's no doubt about the public's reaction.
I asked last Wednesday for the British people to match the contribution of the government, which was then standing at £50 million. Now, it's a question of asking the government to match the generosity of the British people and the way in which individual British people have responded.
The scale of the disaster, the urgent medical need, has caught everyone and every country by surprise. The Liberal Democrats believe now is the time for politicians and governments to work together and act swiftly.
None of us really want to, in a domestic British sense, play party politics with this. All governments internationally, I think, were caught somewhat almost unprepared by the sheer scale of events.
When Tony Blair returns from holiday this week, he'll soon have to decide whether the government should increase its aid and commit more resources, even troops. But as chairman of the leading group of industrialised nations, the G8, the Prime Minister now also has a chance to influence the international community to ensure that it can better respond to such a tragedy when it was so completely unprepared. Jonathan Beale, BBC News, Downing Street.
Prayers have been said for victims of the earthquake at churches across the country, including here at Liverpool's Roman Catholic Cathedral. Church leaders have acknowledged that the disaster could test the faith of many people. Well, now to other news, and 22 people have been killed in a suicide bomb attack on a bus carrying Iraqi National Guardsmen. Two bombers blew up a vehicle packed near a US military base in the Sunni Triangle, where loyalty to Saddam Hussein is still strong. Yeah, train fares went up today by an average of 4%, and the operators say the extra money will be used to improve the rail network. Passenger groups say they want to see things get better before any price rises. Here's our business reporter, Howell Jones.
Another year, another fare increase. Rail companies now routinely raise ticket prices by more than the rate of inflation. Passengers at London Euston today and across Britain are footing the bill for the long and expensive job of improving rail services.
Sometimes you can't get a seat in the main part of the carriage. I'm not that impressed and very unhappy to hear that the fares are going up again.
Obviously, because it's private companies, they have to make a profit, I assume. Can't afford to run at a loss.
The above inflation increases, an average of 4% for season tickets and saver fares. Other fares rise by up to 7% for some Silverlink tickets between Birmingham and London. Walk-on fares, bought on the day of travel, broadly attract the highest rises.
The rail companies say they're investing in new trains, better security and upgrading stations. The rail industry is something which eats up investment every day of every year.
Passenger groups say above inflation increases are testing the patience of commuters.
It's fine charging more if the companies are delivering improved standards for everybody, but the reality is that those improved standards are not yet being delivered.
Rail companies say they are improving, but this new year won't be the last time fares rise by more than the rate of inflation. Howell Jones, BBC News.
Police in Birmingham are continuing to hunt for two men who fled the scene of a hit-and-run accident in which a couple were killed. The family of Keith and Pearl Wine, who had nine children, made an emotional appeal for information about the crash, which happened on New Year's Eve. They said they were horrified that anyone could have left the scene of the accident. In cricket, England enjoyed mixed fortunes on the first day of the third test against South Africa. After losing the toss in Cape Town, England restricted the hosts to 247 for four. Ashley Giles, the most successful bowler, with two wickets. But they've yet to dismiss South Africa's best batsman, Jack Kallis. He finished the day on 81, not out. Well, more now on our main story, the Asian tsunami disaster. As we've heard, Britons have already given £60 million to charity, but some have decided to go a step further. A group of doctors touched by the plight of the tens of thousands of victims have flown to Sri Lanka to do what they can, as our correspondent James Westhead tells us.
You.
A week on, and even now, news of individual tragedies still reaching relatives in the UK. Sassy's heard his family in a remote part of northern Sri Lanka was all but wiped out.
This one, they died.
His only hope now, this GP from Orpington in Kent. She's travelling to the area to help and promises to find the one daughter who miraculously survived.
She went up on their house roof, and then that was collapsing. This little girl was brave enough to hold on a tree branch. That is the only way she survived.
Dr. Pushparaja is carrying the hopes and fears of dozens of British Sri Lankan families, but also medicine and equipment donated by hospitals and pharmacies.
She's leading a team of 9 doctors from across the UK, including surgeons and other specialists who felt they just had to help.
To be honest with you, I'm petrified. I've never done anything like this before in my life. But part of me is extremely excited because I'm going to do my best and do whatever I can.
These doctors are not part of any aid agency. They're part of a growing independent aid effort. People who've just dropped everything to come to the help of their country. They've no idea what lies ahead. When they land, they'll be travelling to the most remote northeast corner of the island, cut off from the outside world for much of the last 20 years. The Tamil Tiger rebels based there are no longer fighting. They're desperate for help. Their villages wiped out, thousands homeless and injured. As the doctors set off on a 10-hour drive to reach the affected areas, there were warnings of flash floods in their way. All they know for sure is their journey and the task ahead won't be easy. James Westhead, BBC News in Sri Lanka.
Let's speak now to our World Affairs editor, John Simpson. John, let's think back to the start of the week when there were deep concerns about the nature and extent of the warnings. Have they now gone away?
I think they have temporarily, actually, Dermot, yes, for the time being, because we've been all swept away, in fact, by this extraordinary public response. And it is a public response. I can't think of anything like this in the last 20 years since the Ethiopia disaster of 1984, when public opinion absolutely dictated what governments had done. And in right across Europe, right across the world, in fact, governments were very slow in responding, didn't know what to do exactly, hadn't thought about it. And the public in each country, I mean, Japan, Ireland, Scandinavia, the United States, Britain, and other countries, forced their governments to give more and more. And so they've been leapfrogging each other. I mean, now the stakes are highest in Japan, where they've offered $500 million. And it's the leapfrogging process is obviously a popular one.
So what does that mean for the future? Are we seeing something genuinely unprecedented happening here with implications for the world coming together, I suppose?
I suppose you, if you were really optimistic, you'd think that. Alas, I think people do forget quite quickly, governments forget. What I do think we can certainly say without any question is that there will be now a proper tsunami warning system in the Indian Ocean, as there is in the Pacific, has been for 50 years in the Pacific, and I think that really we'll find that that's changed, and a lot of people are going to be quite angry about the way it's all been done.
Okay, John, thanks very much. Now here's Alex Deakin with the weather.
Thank you very much, Dermot. Windy sums up the weather so far this year, but things are going to turn wilder over the next couple of days. Stormy weather heading in across much of the United Kingdom this week. Widespread gales, severe gales likely across northern Britain. The strong winds also bringing in some rain, but it will be a little bit milder, certainly milder than it was today. It felt cold out there in the winds. Temperatures struggling across northern Britain to just 4 or 5 Celsius. Tomorrow, most of us up to 9 or 10 Celsius. So a milder day on Monday. Because it's milder, we won't have the snow across Scotland, but we will still have rain coming in here through the morning. Some light rain likely for a time across Northern Ireland and across western parts of England and Wales. We're likely to see some showery outbreaks of rain, but I think much of England and Wales actually staying dry, and particularly in the east, some decent and lengthy spells of sunshine. Not too much of that sunshine, though, for Scotland. Staying cloudy here, and particularly in the north and the west, outbreaks of rain likely throughout the day. The wind's picking up through the day as well, another blustery day, but as we saw earlier, it will be a little bit milder. And then the winds really pick up on Monday night. That's when this weather front will bring rain in, but the strength of the winds giving us some cause for concern. Picking up through the night on Monday night, winds likely to gust up to 60, 70, or possibly 80 miles an hour across northern Britain into Tuesday morning. Those sort of winds could knock down trees, could cause some structural damage, and certainly expecting some travel disruption as most people head back to work on Tuesday morning. Very windy, those strong winds also bringing in wet weather too. The southeastern corner probably starting off dry on Tuesday, but the wet and windy weather will be pushing its way south through the day, then turning brighter further north, but with heavy showers coming in and snow again likely up over the highlands. So the wind's a big feature, as I say, particularly strong on Monday night into Tuesday morning, but we could have a repeat performance on Wednesday. Those winds staying very strong on Wednesday again across northern Britain, the threat of severe gales, and yet again those strong winds bringing in more rain across the north as well. Now, if you want to stay up to date with all the weather warnings, of course, you can always check out CFAX page 400 or go online. But for now, I'll hand you back to Dermot.
Thanks, Alex. The main news tonight, a week after the Asian tsunami disaster, the world's biggest ever aid effort is underway. And that's the latest. There'll be news throughout the night over on BBC News 24. But from all of us, good night.
gloating over people's deaths. It's not right. That's why this is happening.
Your brother is dead. So is a young woman.
There's a difference between burning out a car you're joyriding and burning out a car with someone in it.
Martin Shaw stars in the concluding episode of Murder Room tomorrow at 9 on BBC One.
We get 50 phone calls a week from people mistaking us for ghost hunters.
There's something in my house.
Something going on in that house that we cannot explain.
That we cannot explain yet.
Do you think a poltergeist is controlling me?
Sometimes the unbelievable can mask a dark truth. Exploring the unexplained. Sea of Souls. New weekend drama starts next Saturday at 9 on BBC One.
Night now on BBC One with BBC News 24.
Hello there. It's turning cold out there. More on our weather though in just a moment. Somewhere where it's been cold for a few days is Shanghai. -1 at the maximum on Friday, well below the average for this time of year. Much of northern China, Korea and Japan also been on the cold side of late. We had some snow on New Year's Eve in Tokyo, the first time that's happened for 21 years. Maybe a bit more snow to come across northern Japan from this weather front during Sunday. High pressure though keeping things dry in Shanghai, and slowly as the northerly winds get cut off, we'll see temperatures rising back to where they should be by Monday. Beijing though staying on the cold side. Somewhere else where it's been cold of late, North America, -41 in northern Canada. The cold weather extending down into northern parts of the US as well. But the deep south has actually been pretty warm, temperatures in Texas up to 28 degrees Celsius. Elsewhere in the US, we've had another storm, a lot of heavy rain of late through California. It's been wet here all week, and reports of as much as 200 millimetres of rain falling in LA. And there's more to come. An area of low pressure will bring more snow across the mountains and more wet weather to lower levels across the southwest of the US throughout the weekend. Now, we've had some very lively weather to start our new year, some torrential rain, some very strong winds as well. That weather system now clearing out of the way, but there's a whole host of showers packing in behind it, those showers bringing some problems. Sleet and snow through the night across Northern Ireland, Northern England and North Wales. Most of the snow up over the hills here, but across western and northern Scotland, those snow showers already falling at lower levels. Accompanied with gale force winds, the Met Office have issued a severe weather warning for blizzards. Ice will be a big problem on the roads as well throughout tonight, and we'll keep those snow showers, I think, for much of Sunday as well. Tomorrow is not the day to be heading into the mountains of Scotland. It will be quite dangerous on the hills. Other hills not doing too well either. I don't think there'll be sleet and snow showers on the hills of Northern Ireland, Northern England and North Wales too. Elsewhere, well, there might just be some patchy rain across parts of Devon and Cornwall for a time in the morning, but that will clear, and many southern and eastern counties actually having a fine day. It'll be sunny, although it will be quite blustery. As the day goes on, I think we'll start to see those showers across Northern Ireland, Northwest England in particular, turning back to rain. But it will be a windy day. It'll feel cold, temperatures 6 or 7 Celsius at best for many of us. A bit milder on Monday, a lot of cloud around, but maybe some brighter skies through more eastern parts of England and Wales. Certainly most of England and Wales looking dry on Monday, but across Scotland we will see more rain arriving, maybe some of that heading in for Northern Ireland later on in the day. And the winds picking up again as we head through Monday. Severe gales possibly during Monday night and into Tuesday. So the winds continue to be a feature of our weather throughout this week. Another very windy day on Tuesday. Wet weather pushing south across England and Wales, turning a bit brighter, but with showers across Scotland and Northern Ireland. That's all from me. Good night.
If you want to know the weather, wake up your red button.
Digital viewers can catch weather forecasts for free at any time with BBC Eye. You can check the next 5 days for your local area or international weather for your trip away. Press red now for the latest weather outlook on BBC Eye.
During a period of depression, Jenny developed a mental health problem known as obsessive-compulsive disorder and faced many obstacles in her fight to get back to work. Some employers would turn their backs on those who encounter mental health problems and lose the skills and experience they still have to offer. One in four people will experience mental health problems, so don't discriminate. Find out more.
Let's
Bruce Perry stays a month with a tribe, Monday at 9 on BBC Two.
Through the night now on BBC One with BBC News 24.
Thank you, actor. The production team have told me tonight I'm staying somewhere that's innovative and revolutionary. And it's called Karawusa. According to the map, it is here, but surely this can't be it. Oh, hello. I have a reservation for tonight. My name is Mark B.
Shut up! Your name is nobody. Move.
Oh, okay. Would you like to take my bag?
Just move!
So keep your hat on. I'm sorry. Now, one thing I will be needing is internet access here, and also I was wondering whether you have a spot.
Get in here and get changed. Here is your uniform.
Well, hang on a sec. I don't quite understand. Hello? Hello?
Say it to your mommy.
Welcome to Karawusta Military Prison. Do what you're told to do, disobey the orders, and you'll be severely punished. Welcome to hell. Yes, the production team hadn't quite told me everything about this alternative accommodation, and its last official inmate was only released 7 years ago. But under the supervision of local historians, this harsh, cold building has opened its secretive doors, partly to demonstrate that Latvia has moved on from its painful and dark past. A daytime tour of this prisoner's paradise costs just £3. That's about $5.50. But for twice that amount, the brave or foolhardy tourist can book an overnight stay in a place where temperatures in the winter can plummet to minus 30. And this is my bed for the night. Oh, a single plank of wood. And it's not even a single either. No. I'm sharing it with about 100 fleas. No luxury toilet paper or bidet here, and this is your bathroom with cold and even colder running. As the damp walls and darkness envelop you, the building seems colder than outside. The toilet comprises of four holes in the floor, and visitors need to exercise in the courtyard just to stay warm. And don't be surprised if you're woken at 2 a.m. if not by rats, then by guards threatening you. Not surprisingly, there are plenty of stories of ghosts driving inmates and officers insane. Locals tell of light bulbs dropping out of their sockets, doors slamming, and distant screams. It all makes for a short, sharp shock in Latvian retro chic. But what do you expect for $9 a night? Let's just hope their level of customer service doesn't give the low-cost airlines any ideas.
This summer, much of southern Russia is going ballet crazy. Here at the Black Sea Resort of Anapa, the archaeological site of Gergipia provided a spectacular backdrop for an evening of dance. It attracted crowds from all over the country and sent out a message designed to worry the traditional ballet capitals of Moscow and St. Petersburg in the north. The man responsible for the upsurge of interest in dance is a world-famous choreographer Yuri Grigorovich, who's been staging the greatest ballets at the Bolshoi Theatre for over 30 years. Now he has moved to the southern city of Krasnodar and is trying to turn the capital of the region into a new ballet center. The first ever All-Russia contest has just taken place there. Performers from Moscow, St. Petersburg, Nizhny Novgorod, Novosibirsk, Kazan and other major ballet dancing schools of Russia all traveled to Krasnodar to display their talents and compete for an overall prize fund of over $500,000. But these dancers are not here just for the money. For them, this is a chance to get a ticket to the major league in Russian ballet. The story of the Krasnodar Theatre of Ballet and Opera is that of Cinderella. A local troupe has been taken by the master and turned into a successful enterprise.
I don't like comparisons, and especially with such great troupes as in Moscow or St. Petersburg. Those are great companies and have hundreds of years of history behind them, whereas we are quite a young ballet troupe. So we are trying our best, and somehow the world has noticed us. Foreign impresarios come over to Krasnodar, and we are being invited all over the world.
Several years ago, many of these young dancers would only dream about touring the world with one of the Russia's most famous ballerinas. Today, she's in Krasnodar, and these dancers hope that, instead, the world will now come to them. For a city with almost no tourists, the hope is that from now on, a thriving ballet scene will attract people who have previously preferred to stay at the beach resorts some 3 hours away.
Two very different faces there of the former Soviet Union. While still to come here on Fast Track, how hotel rooms are becoming the same the world over. The Bosnian town, which has turned into one of the world's biggest Roman Catholic pilgrimage sites. And one of our band of intrepid Fast Track correspondents goes above and beyond the call of duty to bring you a report from the adventure sports capital of the world. That's all still to come here on this week's show, so stay with us on Fast Track. Now, in 2004, trends in hotel design continued to cause debate. So, in April, we sent Sham Ambiyabaga to find out whether the rumours about the death of minimalism were greatly exaggerated or greatly overdue.
Am I in a hospital? Oh no, just another hotel with white walls. Is it Thursday? Got to be Milan, or maybe Frankfurt. Hey, it's that clock from Paris. Not another minimalist bathroom. Fed up with baby in the horse's trough. Will I ever find my way to my room? I remember a corridor just like this in Toronto. And this is like some back passage at Heathrow Airport where they store the illegal immigrants. It's the nowhere land of interior design.
In fact, this is the Sanderson Hotel in central London. It's the creation of no less a designer than Philippe Starck.
Actually, this is the Hempel, designed and named after one of Britain's foremost designers.
And this is St Martin's Lane. But truly, I could be anywhere. The problem for even the most famous designers is that the travelling cognoscenti are getting bored with just more of the same.
Good design and good architecture is not a competitive advantage anymore. This is a minimum requirement. If you're not building something nice today, you have problems from the first day.
And just what is good design? What makes a place interesting to be in? It's certainly not having exactly the same mass-produced artworks in every room.
But hotel design does cry out for mass production. It would be simply uneconomical to furnish each room differently, both in terms of buying and of maintenance. And everything that's mass-produced can be equally painlessly disposed of.
But if a well-designed building is not enough, what do hoteliers have to do to keep up with the fickle whims of their highest-paying customers?
I think that people are looking more and more for authenticity. When you look in the future and think about what is the next big thing in wellness, I think many people already get more out of half a day discussion with a martial artist or a yogi who lives in Tibet than out of the 150th treatment they have received. You know, luxury today is not driving a Porsche, but it's knowing how to make a tom yum kum in a really right way.
Well, offering clients the chance to talk to a Tibetan yogi or a lesson in Thai cookery seems a little desperate.
But authenticity is a key point. Authenticity to the location.
This is the design dilemma for the 21st century, and I'm rather surprised that the anti-globalisation lobby isn't gunning for interior designers. A century ago, if you just travelled outside your region, let alone your country, you could expect to be overwhelmed by the new environment. These days, it's all comfortingly the same.
Shan Mambiabagova and her musings on minimalism. Now, back in August, we brought you a special programme from the Balkans in which Inga Lovrić-Kemp visited a village in Bosnia, which is proving, certainly in terms of tourism, that miracles can really happen.
Medjugorje is probably not high on the must-see list of many of the world's tourists, but the story of this village is well known to many Catholics around the world. Ever since six local schoolchildren claimed to have seen a vision of the Virgin Mary on these hills in 1981, this quiet and unassuming spot in the southern Bosnia and Herzegovina has turned into the second largest Catholic pilgrimage site in the world. It's here that the Virgin Mary is said to have appeared and spoken to the children. That event has attracted much skepticism and controversy, yet on average it's thought that nearly 1 million people a year from all corners of the globe come here. Now, Mass in the local church is held hourly and is sometimes translated into up to 16 languages.
I've come all the way from Australia and I just wanted to come here to see what it's like.
I spoke several people to come here to feel the love of the Virgin Mary.
Remarkably, Medjugorje's success has evolved despite the fact that the Pope hasn't recognized it as an official pilgrimage site and actually refused to visit here during his trip to neighboring Croatia in 1998. In just over 23 years, the village of Medjugorje has been transformed into a commercial pilgrimage site which can accommodate more than 10,000 people a day. And what was once the heart of this sleepy village is now a high street full of souvenir shops and restaurants.
Inga Lovrić-Kemp reporting there from Bosnia back in August. Now, if your idea of fun is being suspended at the end of an elasticated rope and dangling hundreds of feet up in the air, then there's one place you should head for. In April, we sent Christian Maynard to Queenstown in New Zealand.
When you talk about adventure tourism in New Zealand, this is where it all began. Queenstown was put on the map with the first commercial bungee jump on November the 12th, 1988. Since then, 450,000 people have taken the plunge. Make that 450,000 and one.
And this is about where most people change their mind. The secret to bungee's success? High perceived but low actual risk. It's all basic physics, really. What people pay $85 for is the fear.
What is actually extreme is what people go through in their minds. And so from a marketing perspective, when we started, we had to convince people that we're very safe and that it was a bit extreme. And at that stage, we didn't differentiate so much between the sort of the emotional and intellectual and physical levels.
In the extreme sports game, innovation is the key. Making things taller and scarier than ever before brings visitors back for more and makes headlines. The evolution of bungee is a good example. Born as a fertility rite in the South Pacific, developed by the Oxford Dangerous Sports Club and commercialised by the New Zealanders. From the original bridge jump of 15 years ago, there's now a heart-stopping high wire version and an airborne variant that's purely for the serious adrenaline junkie.
That's you hooked up and now backed up.
Parasail bungee. Strap yourself in for Queenstown's latest attraction, the para bungee. 180 metres up and straight down. Whose bright idea was this?
I can't tell you how scared I am right now.
Christian Maynard there, testing his nerves down under in New Zealand. Now, from one extreme to another, earlier in the year, we visited the inaugural snow show in Finnish Lapland. As temperatures plunged to minus 30, internationally renowned artists and architects gathered and collaborated to create a breathtaking show, which will happen again this year. Now, when we visited Iceland back in 2003, I was fortunate enough to catch a glimpse of the breathtaking Northern Lights, something that our reporter Simon Hancock has never really forgiven me for.
I'd had enough hearing from Akhtar about his breathtaking Northern Lights experience. This had to be my best chance of seeing the phenomenon for myself and finally shutting him up. That night, though, as the temperature plunged, nothing. I needed somehow to improve my chances. The next evening, I decided to plunge further into the wilderness. If nothing else, it was a good excuse for a spot of snowmobiling. Visibility, though, did not look good. No, things were looking hopeless. Like many who come here, I was discovering that it just isn't that easy.
Good.
Was Akhtar perhaps somehow more lucky than me? It was a depressing thought. But then a tip-off that there was a less painful way of pursuing this Holy Grail. The tourist board here had set up a new service to alert visitors to the light's presence. Sign up, give your mobile number, and there's no need to wait around in the cold for hours. A camera with special filters linked to a computer watches the sky. When the lights are performing, you get sent a text message. Genius. But for me, it was SMS silence. This was the closest I was going to get. Along with this irritating present I'd been given, a joke tin of Northern Lights.
Yeah, thanks very much, Akhtar.
It was time to call it a night.
Simon Hancock failing once again to catch a glimpse of these ever-elusive Northern Lights. Well, that's it for this look back at 2004. I do hope that you continue to join us on our travels in 2005 and carry on emailing us at fasttracktravel@bbc.co.uk. But until next time, from me, Akhtar Khan, and the entire Fast Track team, goodbye, enjoy your travels.
Hello there, it's turning colder and some of us are going to see snow today. Certainly temperatures are close to freezing out there now. A touch of frost, one or two icy roads around. That wind brings some sleet and snow showers into the north and the west, particularly of Scotland. Blizzards at times over the northwest highlands, ice affecting other routes across Scotland, so some nasty conditions on the roads first thing. So the worst of the wintry showers for the north and west of Scotland, parts of Northern Ireland, feeding into northwestern parts of England and Wales too. Sunny skies though for eastern Scotland, the south and east of England. The odd spot of rain for Cornwall, just for a time through this morning, but that will tend to die away. And I think we'll see a trend through this afternoon to turn those sleet and snow showers back to rain for Northern Ireland, northwest England, western Scotland, but staying pretty wintry across the far north. Better the sunshine though, as you can see, across the south and the east of the UK. Despite that, it's not going to feel all that warm out there. Sixes and sevens at best across the southeast, despite the sunshine, and very cold indeed further north. Four or five for Scotland, with a considerable wind chill.
Who chose the colours?
Me. I didn't want blue.
Now they are five and growing fast.
Join me, Professor Robert Winston, as Trial of Our Time returns Tuesday at 9 on BBC One.
This week in Talking Movies, what's in store? A preview of cinema in 2005. And John Travolta, he's never looked quite the same before.
With BBC Eye, I can control the way I catch up on the news. By pressing red on my digital remote from any BBC channel, I can get the latest national and local headlines as well as weather forecasts whenever I want.
A summary of the news, which starts off with...
Now I can select the stories I want to see, in the order I want to see them.
BBC Eye, the BBC, at your beck and call.
So that news just in. Well, let's update you on the very latest headlines. Let's get the latest on the day of the event.
More correspondence.
Some warning shots were fired from this Israeli watchtower.
The force of the blast blew debris several hundred metres.
More analysis.
Just how is that investigation going? Quite a lot has actually been said behind the scenes.
Which means if it happens, it happens here. 24 hours a day. BBC News 24.
Chosen by the backbenchers of the House of Commons to be their speaker was an accolade. Everybody has the opportunity to watch what is going on in Parliament, both in the Commons and in the Lords. So it does bring the give an opportunity for members of the public to almost come onto the floor of the House and to listen themselves to exactly what is said. How do I feel about the BBC Parliament Channel? I'm 1,000% in favour of it.
Says the United Nations is facing the largest disaster it's ever had to deal with. He warns countries hit by the Asian tsunamis could take up to 10 years to recover. $2 billion from 40 countries around the world have been pledged to help the victims. But severe weather and flash flooding is hampering the relief effort in some areas. Ceremonies to mark the tragedy and honour the dead are held in dozens of countries. Hello, you're welcome to BBC News. I'm Deborah McKenzie. The UN Secretary General Kofi Annan says countries hit by the Asian tsunami could take up to 10 years to recover. He said it was the largest disaster the UN had ever had to deal with. The UN estimates that more than 150,000 people have died, but says the total number may never be known. Indonesia is the worst affected country with more than 80,000 people killed. Andrew Harding has just sent this report from the city of Banda Aceh, much of which has been completely destroyed.
We left the ruins of the city behind us and set out by boat to search the coastline. The sea still littered with bodies. But it was survivors we were hoping to find. Our crew suggested heading for a nearby island, its shoreline ominously bare.
2,000 people are staying here in this village, but die 1,500. Left 500. With a bad condition.
And there's nothing left there at all.
Nothing
left.
All house is missing.
No sign of life. Until suddenly this.
Well, we just spotted these families here simply standing on the shoreline waiting for help. We're going to go in now and see if we can take some away to safety.
A forlorn crowd waiting in the rubble. They couldn't scramble on board fast enough. After 6 days and nights of thirst and anguish and hunger. 800 died in our village, said this man. We've been surviving on whatever we could find in the jungle. Heading back for the mainland. But minutes later, another smaller group of survivors came racing out to intercept us and ask for a lift. Inside, relief mixed with fear of the open sea and another tsunami. I'm still scared, said Nusida Ansari. The waves took my daughter. My son's at school on the mainland, but I don't know if he's alive. Corpses on the riverbank. We were back in the provincial capital. A shocked silence on the boat. But the stench familiar to all here now. Then they clambered off, helping hands to pull them up. These people have lost everything. They are starting life from scratch today. A grim prospect in this ravaged city. Andrew Harding, BBC News in Aceh, Indonesia.
In Sri Lanka, severe weather is hampering the relief effort. Flash floods have washed away roads, preventing aid workers from reaching remote parts of the island. The death toll there has now risen to more than 28,000. From Ampara, Jeremy Byrne reports.
It's about survival now, here on the east coast of Sri Lanka. Huge sums of money are being committed to this relief operation. But here, it still depends on the Sri Lankan Air Force's Vietnam-era helicopters. These people escaped the tsunami, only to be cut off in the last few days by torrential monsoon rains and heavy flooding. The weather is the latest blow to a relief operation that will be massive, but still has barely touched parts of this country. Floods have poured down from the mountains in the interior. Roads that should be full of convoys of heavy lorries carrying relief supplies are in some places being washed away.
Many people who had started to go back to their homes, which were damaged, have now gone back to camps where they can get aid and they know they will get shelter. This means that there's many more people in bad conditions.
And so much needs to be done. Right along Sri Lanka's east coast, there's a broad band of destruction in places more than a mile deep. The biggest problem in the devastated areas is now public health. Alerts have gone out from UNICEF warning that waterborne diseases, including cholera, are now a real threat. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, on the east coast of Sri Lanka.
Rescue teams in Thailand are warning that it could be weeks before all those killed in the disaster are identified. The number of lives lost in Thailand is now more than 4,800, with another 6,000 missing. Kylie Morris reports from Phuket.
These forensics experts are now any relative's best hope of finding the body of their loved ones. This team is from Germany. Others have come from Britain. They take DNA samples from the corpses stored inside refrigeration containers. It's a task that's both gruesome and time-consuming. Relatives from the UK are put through to this emergency coordination centre in Phuket, run by the Foreign Office, staffed by volunteers. For many who call here, it's a difficult decision whether or not they should undertake the journey to Thailand. And there's no firm advice, even from the British ambassador.
We do point out to them the difficulties that they will encounter and the trauma that they may encounter in going to mortuaries, body collection places. So they shouldn't think that it's going to be an easy task, but it's their decision whether they come or not.
Still not clear how many lives have been lost here, but the cleaning up is already underway. At Patong Beach, signs that the tourist town is picking itself up.
Phuket will recover. This looks bad, but the damage, in fact, is limited to the beachfront, and the infrastructure here is fairly much intact.
Bar owners like Denzel Trevitt from Kent believe tourists won't be put off for very long.
If it was a bomb, yeah, I think you're correct. People won't come here. This was a natural disaster. No, it's no one's fault. It was just a natural disaster. So people will come. People will come back here again.
And even as they do, ceremonies like this are underway to put the spirits of the dead at rest. Kylie Morris, BBC News, Phuket.
The Indian military in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands has acknowledged that there are massive logistical problems in getting aid to survivors of the sea surges. 6,000 people are officially listed as dead or missing, but it's thought at least 10,000 more are not accounted for. In the worst affected area of the Indian mainland, it's estimated that as many as 40% of the victims were children. It's now feared that some villages have lost an entire generation of people. At least 9,000 have been killed, most in the state of Tamil Nadu, from where Nick Bryant sent us this report.
The new year started as the old one ended, with the people of Nagapattinam desperate for aid. Here they were receiving soap and biscuits. If you've lost almost everything, anything helps. Much of the aid effort here is targeted at preventing the spread of disease, and public health officials are confident they've stopped the spread of cholera. Still, they can't be sure. At times, it seems, the aid effort isn't being that well coordinated. These men were told by the authorities to pick up clothes from the side of the street, which charity workers had left for the victims. A form of relief which appeared to be working well. All along the shoreline, we're hearing stories of terrible loss. This was a children's playground, wiped away by the tsunami. Some of its climbing frames were tossed 500 meters inland. Last Sunday, it was crowded with young children. It was the weekend. They didn't have to go to school. Just two survived the tsunami, and more than 40 were killed. It's thought many of their bodies are still buried in the sand. Other badly decomposed bodies still litter this coastline, almost a week on, and they've yet to recover all the dead. Nick Bryant, BBC News, Nagapattinam.
A team of US Marines is on its way to the Maldives to assess the damage there. The relief operation is complicated because the wreckage is spread over hundreds of small islands.
These video images show the Maldives nearly a week ago. The tsunami has killed over 70 people, most of them children. This nation is made up of over 1,000 tiny coral islands, and like the other parts of this region, their sandy white beaches are usually a target for holidaymakers. But now it's feared that dozens of these resorts have been totally destroyed, and the sheer number of them is making the rescue operation difficult. A team of US Marines is expected to arrive soon to assess the extent of the damage. The president of the Maldives has been touring the islands, inspecting the wreckage and meeting the survivors. 300,000 people live here, and more than a third of them have been affected. The parliamentary elections that were scheduled for December the 31st have been postponed until later in the month. And as a conciliatory gesture, the president has dropped treason charges against a number of his opponents in recognition that this is not a time for fighting, but for rebuilding. Catherine Bennett, BBC News.
Well, the United Nations says that $2 billion has now been raised in aid for the Asian earthquake disaster. The single largest donor is Japan, which has promised up to $500 million. The British public has raised £60 million to help victims of the disaster.
Never has so much money been given in so little time by so many people. The Disasters Emergency Committee says the £60 million mark was reached at 2 p.m. today, and donations keep pouring in.
So what will all that generosity buy? Well, £6,500 will pay for a surgical kit to perform 100 operations. £120 pays for an emergency shelter for 8 people, and £1 buys rehydration salts to treat one person with diarrhea.
But in some countries, especially Indonesia, getting aid to those who need it is proving a logistical nightmare.
In some of these smaller airports, it really is like a traffic jam. There's too many planes trying to get in, and then once they're there, trying to offload the equipment and to get it out to communities is hard. However, we are confident that we can get aid into Bandar Aceh within the next 48 hours and deliver water to about 50,000 people in the surrounding area.
The main health risk is from water contaminated with sewage. cholera is now a severe threat. A lot of effort has gone into digging mass graves. World Health officials say the focus should instead be on helping survivors. They say it's a misconception that unburied bodies spread disease.
There is not a great health risk. And in many communities, the belief that you have to deal with the bodies very quickly make us and the local communities bury them in haste, and there are emotional scars forever among the local communities.
The UN estimates there are 5 million people without the basic needs for survival, and it will take many days to reach all of them, and months or years to rebuild communities. Fergus Walsh, BBC News.
Still ahead, personal stories of survival. The new mother whose baby was born as she fled the waves. Heathrow Airport has seen more tearful reunions. The British government chartered a plane from Bangkok to bring home 94 survivors of the tsunami disaster, most of them British tourists, with more harrowing tales of how they'd survived the waves. The official number of British nationals killed is 35, but is expected to rise.
Back home and into the arms of their loved ones, the latest group of Britons to be caught by the tsunami flew in from Bangkok on board a BA jet specially chartered by the Foreign Office. Others arrived on scheduled flights. All know they're lucky to be alive. But the losses endured by some are heart-rending. 16-year-old Louis Barrett Mullen and his 12-year-old brother Theo from Cornwall lost their parents, Catherine and Leonard, in the waves near Phuket. They're both still missing, presumed dead. Tonight, the orphan boys are back in the UK after their aunt flew to fetch them. Charlie Anderson was snorkeling with friends at Krabi. He was in the water with their boat above him when the massive waves tore into the Thai coastline. Unlike so many others, they all survived.
So I'm around to be confronted by a good 25, 30, 40. It's very hard to tell, but in the water looking up, it looked fast. And boat went over my head, was sucked underneath. I remember the propeller sort of flashing past my face.
Having been at the heart of disaster, their homecoming was all the sweeter. But for many British families, nature has taken everything. Clarence Mitchell, BBC News.
The headlines here on BBC News. Kofi Annan has warned that countries hit by the Asian tsunamis could take up to 10 years to recover. $2 billion has been pledged to help the tsunami victims in an unprecedented show of global compassion. The UN says the main challenge now will be to deliver aid despite the smashed infrastructure. In other news, it's 3 years since the launch of the euro, but in Greece, the new currency is far from popular. There have been protests about high prices, and Greece has been formally warned by the EU for hugely underreporting its budget deficit before joining the currency. That has added to anger about the euro and nostalgia for its predecessor, the drachma.
This cobbler's in the middle-class Athenian suburb of Pankrati is a barometer of the fortunes of a people fiercely proud about keeping up appearances. Nikos Trakopoulos has never been busier, dealing with clients who, since the introduction of the euro, have struggled to make ends meet.
They count every cent. In the past, they would throw shoes away and they wouldn't get them repaired. But now, they don't throw so much away as they did. The shoes they bring, they're not the high-quality shoes they used to bring a lot. And only shoes, but belts, garments, bags, whatever, for as cheap as possible to get them fixed.
Next door, at a beauty parlour, the economic indicators tell a similar story. Manicurist Stephanie Nikolakopoulou estimates that her takings are down by 60% this year, and she blames across-the-board price rises caused by the euro.
When customers realized what was happening in the economy, they stopped paying cash and started using their credit cards. But now their cards are maxed out and they haven't got any spare cash at all.
This is the morning price for a kilo and this is my afternoon price. It's awful, says Spiros Frotakis at Pankratis Laiki. These are the weekly street markets where Greeks have traditionally obtained nutritious food at bargain prices. Now stallholders are struggling to cover their costs. Spiros says the people here start shopping just before the market is about to close, when I have to drop prices. I've got about 100 kilos of tomatoes, unsold. No one has got any money. His neighbour is virtually giving away produce at the end of the day. The euro is for the rich, he says. It's done nothing for poor people. Greek public anger has been exacerbated recently since it was revealed that the previous government massaged its accounts in order to adopt the euro. If it had told the truth, the much-loved drachma would still be in use. Later this year, some of the new European Union member countries will be using the euro for the first time. Greece's experience is a cautionary tale about what can happen if the economy is not ready. Malcolm Brabant, BBC News, Athens.
British aid worker Margaret Hassan, who was taken hostage in Iraq last year and is believed to have been executed by her abductors, has been awarded Ireland's most prestigious peace prize. The Tipperary International Peace Prize Award, previously won by former presidents Nelson Mandela, Mikhail Gorbachev and Bill Clinton, will be received by relatives on her behalf. She was 59 in April. In other news, there's been more violence in Iraq. Gunmen have shot dead a council leader in the town of Bakuba, north of Baghdad. The group linked to the wanted al-Qaeda militant, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, said it carried out the killing. In Baghdad, police say they found two decapitated bodies in the west of the city. Meanwhile, Lebanon says one of its citizens was shot dead in Baghdad by an unidentified sniper. The man widely expected to win the Palestinian presidential election next weekend, Mahmoud Abbas, says he might be able to persuade militant groups like Hamas to agree to a ceasefire in their conflict with Israel. Mr. Abbas said he would use the way of persuasion and negotiation rather than force. But he also said he has no immediate plans to disarm Palestinian militants. Two political groups in Pakistan are holding separate meetings to discuss how best to oppose President Pervez Musharraf's decision to stay on as head of the army. Earlier, one of the opposition alliances organized protest rallies across the country. The MMA said the president had reneged on a promise to relinquish his military role. Well, the victims of the tsunami have been remembered around the world. More than half the European victims came from Scandinavia. In Sweden, they've held a national day of mourning to honour their 60 dead and the 3,500 who are still missing.
In Sweden and across Scandinavia, the flags are at half-mast to signal the shock of whole nations. More than half of the tourists who died in Thailand are thought to have come from Sweden, Norway and Denmark. 3,500 Swedes are still missing, but the collections are for their Thai hosts and companions in grief.
The response has been overwhelming. People have been calling us, approaching us, asking how they can contribute, what they can do to help. So I'm hoping that we will look at something close to $1 million in the collections this Sunday.
Amidst their grief, some Swedes have been critical of their government for its slowness to react and for what newspapers have said was the lack of help reaching the survivors. Even the Prime Minister has acknowledged this as one of Sweden's greatest tragedies. Italians too, with some 700 missing in Thailand, have been shaken, but they have also been quick to raise money for relief aid.
We are also concretely doing something in this demonstration here in Rome, all over the world, in 70 different countries of the world. We are starting a collection of funds so that we can help a project in Aceh and in other areas of Indonesia and in India.
Across Europe, the injured and the survivors are returning home. These French tourist casualties arrived back in Paris, battered by the tsunami, but thankful to be alive. And here in Britain, there were some emotional reunions as more of the travellers made it back home. A new year like few others, which won't easily be forgotten. Jim Fish, BBC News.
And survivors have been speaking about their traumatic experiences.
Suddenly, the big waves of water rushed into our compartment. The whole area was covered, and the train turned around 90 degrees. In a minute, it looked like a fish tank, and we were like fish trying to move around. I couldn't think of anyone. I mean, my loved ones, wife and daughter. I had to cling on to the roof of the train compartment. I only feel sorry for my family members. Then we saw the second and third waves coming, greater than the first. We knew in a moment that we were going to get killed. I told my daughter and wife to do something to rescue themselves. My daughter said not to worry, that she could swim and would try to save her life. I think she tried to do that. When I found her body the next day, it was lying upside down in a swimming position.
How the country is divided into areas of total devastation, and then 1 yard further over, everything is normal and quiet and peaceful like Thailand usually is. I mean, that is totally unexpected to me somehow.
All the villages were destroyed and sank in the ground. We all crawled our way up the steep hills. If we hadn't, we wouldn't be alive. Those who were unable to climb the hills are all gone.
Sunday morning there was this big earthquake. I fell down. Then there was so much water coming that we had to run deep into the jungle. There I delivered my baby. My family was there, but no doctor and no nurse. Somehow we managed, but I was really unwell. We had to stay like that for 2 to 3 days. My condition became very serious. Then on Wednesday, the Navy ship evacuated us and brought me here.
And like, you open the curtains and you've got the second floor balcony, and the waves are like that high. The whole, got out of the room, like the whole building collapsed on us. And there's just stuff that, and you go under the water, but you can't get up because this thing's blocking you and you had to get up. He managed to get onto the piece of land, and then the current just took me out, and I got trapped between some concrete and wood on my head, and this Thai man, he said he pulled me out, but then I saw his body washed up. Someone up there didn't want me to go today, and I made it, but it's not fair on the people that didn't make it.
Stories of heroism and trauma from the survivors of the tsunami. I'm Deborah McKenzie, and this is BBC News. That's all for the moment. Stay with us in the hours ahead.
Hello there, it's got colder again. Some of us will see snow today. There's been snow in Japan too. Tokyo has had its first New Year's Day snowfall for 21 years, so quite unusual. And it's been distinctly nippy across other parts of the Far East too. In Shanghai, in China, just -1 as a maximum on Friday, compared to the average of 11 degrees. So a bit of a cold snap here, and it's distinctly nippy outside. Back home, temperatures close to freezing around about dawn. The cold accentuated by a blustery wind coming in from the west or the northwest, and that wind is carrying a number of heavy sleet and snow showers, especially to Scotland. The northwest highlands getting battered by blizzards at times well on into the morning. Ice affecting other routes across Scotland, so some dodgy conditions here. And those heavy snow showers continuing across the north and west of Scotland through this morning, but with some shelter further east, Aberdeenshire, Fife down towards Lothian. Plenty of sunshine on offer. To the east of the Pennines too, it should be mostly dry, right? But further west, we will see wintry showers piling into the Pennines, Cumbrian Fells as well. So some nasty conditions here. Plenty of brightness for many southern and eastern parts of the UK. Bright, if rather breezy. One exception, the far southwest, primarily Cornwall. Some thicker cloud just for a time here. Some spots of rain. As that comes up over the moors, the risk of that turning to a little bit of sleet or wet snow just for a time. Now through the afternoon, I think we're going to see a bit of a trend as wintry showers turning back to rain for parts of Northern Ireland, western parts of Scotland, northwest England too, turning more generally cloudy out west, but certainly the best of the sunshine remains further south and east. And big games taking place this afternoon in the SPL. Celtic playing Livingston. It will be cold out there, the risk of a wintry shower with some sunny spells. Certainly further east at Easter Road, as Hibs play Hearts, it should be fine and dry but it will feel cold. For the racing, no real problems. Dry, but a nip in the air. Sixes and sevens for Southall and Plumpton. The best of the sunshine, certainly across the south and east of England through this afternoon. Glorious afternoon, really, if you can get out of that breeze, because that breeze will have a bit of an edge to it. No higher than 7 or 8 in the south. That's colder than yesterday, and distinctly chilly further north, 4 or 5 across Scotland at best, with a considerable wind chill. What a contrast with Cape Town, where the third test starts today. South Africa playing England, warm and sunny, but there will be quite a gusty wind around. So we've got that trend to turn the snow showers back to rain later on in the day. And overnight we'll see some patchy rain for many northern areas. Bit of sleet or snow over the high ground for a time before it turns back to rain. Temperatures rising as we go into Monday, back into double figures across the southern areas. This is where the best of the brightness will be. Further north and west, always more clouds. Some outbreaks of rain again for northwestern parts of Northern Ireland. Western Scotland turning wet and very windy later on. We'll have weather fronts piling up across the north and the west. They'll be edging their way southwards and eastwards. Some very strong winds that are just ahead of those fronts, tracking down across England and Wales. And that front will take much of Tuesday before it clears away from the south and the east. So rather cloudy here, with some outbreaks of rain from time to time. Brightening up behind, some sunshine for many northern areas on Tuesday. Again, the best of the brightness in the east. We'll have some showers packing into the west, and again, renewed risk of gales across the far northwest. Into Wednesday, it remains unsettled. It remains windy, particularly in the north. We'll have further heavy showers here. Best of the sunshine once more across the south and the east. Here's a summary.
More coverage.
So that news just in. Well, let's update you on the very latest headlines. Let's get the latest on the day of the event.
More correspondence.
Some warning shots were fired from this Israeli watchtower.
The force of the blast blew debris several hundred metres.
More analysis.
Just how is that investigation going? Quite a lot has actually been said behind the scenes.
Which means if it happens, it happens here, 24 hours a day. BBC News 24.
I can control the way I catch up on the news. By pressing red on my digital remote from any BBC channel, I can get the latest national and local headlines as well as weather forecasts whenever I want.
A summary of the news, which starts off with...
Now I can select the stories I want to see in the order I want to see them.
BBC I, the BBC, at your beck and call.
And the main news. The UN Secretary General Kofi Annan says countries hit by the Asian tsunami disaster could take up to 10 years to recover. Emergency aid is being handed out in the Indonesian province of Aceh 6 days after it was devastated by a tsunami. 12 US helicopters arrived in the region, and the UN is organizing the airlift of 400 tons of emergency supplies. The US Secretary of State Colin Powell is due to fly out to the region today to assess the relief effort. Mr. Powell, who will be accompanied by the president's brother, the Florida governor Jeb Bush, is expected to go to Thailand and Indonesia. International donors have now promised more than $2 billion in aid, with Japan pledging a quarter of the amount. Donations from the British public have reached £60 million. In Sri Lanka, flash floods caused by more than 24 hours of torrential rain have hampered relief efforts. Key roads into stricken areas have been washed away, and a number of emergency camps have been flooded. Strong aftershocks have also been continuing across the region, with one reported near 7 on the Richter scale. Here, more holidaymakers who escaped the disaster have been returning home. Among them were two young brothers whose parents are still missing in Thailand. They were brought back by their aunt. In other news, a nurse on her way to work on New Year's Eve has been killed with her husband in a hit and run involving a stolen car in Birmingham. Police are searching for two men who got out of a Mercedes involved in the collision and ran off. Pearl Wine and her husband Keith were going to the city hospital in Birmingham, where she was due on duty. They had 9 children. Sergeant Paul Bennett is investigating what happened and says he can't believe the behaviour of the two people in the Mercedes.
It's a despicable act that's left two people dead at the roadside. I think the behaviour of both occupants of the Mercedes is callous beyond words. How they can leave two middle-aged people dying at the roadside and make off without any consideration for them is absolutely despicable. My contempt is beyond words.
A 27-year-old man is still being questioned by police in Shropshire about the murder of a pregnant teenager. The body of 14-year-old Amy Williams was found in a churchyard near Telford on Monday. She'd been strangled. Detectives say they have CCTV footage of her from the night she was last seen. An 8-year-old boy has been killed and a 2-year-old girl is in hospital after a tree fell on them as they walked in a park in Greater Manchester. Police were called to Dunham Park near Altrincham, where the boy and girl had been walking with two other people. Rail fares are rising by an average of 4%, an increase which is above the rate of inflation. The train companies say the higher fares will pay for investment in new trains. Fares for the Silverlink service between Birmingham and London will rise by 7%. The Rail Passengers Council says commuters should see significant improvements in services before the above inflation fare rises. And don't forget, you can keep up to date with all the headlines, weather and sport through our interactive service. Press the red button and then just follow the on-screen instructions. That's the news. Now on BBC News 24, it's time for Talking Movies.
Hello from New York. I'm Tom Brooke. In today's programme, a new year, a new pack of films. Sean Penn in a gripping true life drama. And Mike Leigh, one of Britain's greatest living directors, in the spotlight. All that and more in this edition of Talking Movies.
Talking Movies. Talking Movies. Talking Movies. Talking Movies. Talking
Movies. It's a new year and a new onslaught of entertainment on celluloid stands before us. Here's Manoush Somrodi with a sample of what you can look forward to in cinema in 2005.
You loved them in 2004, or maybe not. But most of those familiar faces will be back in 2005. The big stars have some big projects lined up.
This is international territory.
In The Interpreter, Sean Penn plays a CIA agent who's charged with protecting a UN translator. That's Nicole Kidman. She's overheard plans for an assassination. And Cinderella Man, the Oscar-winning duo of director Ron Howard and actor Russell Crowe come together again for this drama about legendary boxer Jim Braddock.
Very nice to meet you. It's a
pleasure. Monster-in-Law marks the comeback of Jane Fonda and yet another comedy romance for Jennifer Lopez.
Chewing gum is really gross. Chewing gum I hate the most.
And Johnny Depp reprises the role of Willy Wonka and his chocolate factory, based on that beloved children's book by Roald Dahl. 2005 will also, of course, see a myriad of sequels. Christian Bale plays the next caped crusader in Batman Begins. He's extremely confident about his take on the superhero.
I just looked at what hadn't been done with the character and saw that everybody agreed that that was the direction they wanted to take it in. I had to audition for this movie and I decided just to, that I didn't want to do it if they didn't want to do it in the way that I felt it should be done.
In addition to Batman, some of the other old favorites are back. The final installment of Star Wars comes in the form of Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. And the fourth Harry Potter will arrive, this time with a goblet of fire.
But what about smaller films or movies that won't necessarily be blockbusters but may intrigue us all the same? Well, it's hard to predict which lesser-known actors or films may have a breakthrough in 2005, but there are already some less commercial projects which are showing some promise.
They are hardly unknown, but both Sigourney Weaver and Daniel Day-Lewis play parents in art house films next year. Already in limited release in U.S. cinemas, Imaginary Heroes star Sigourney Weaver as the matron of the Travis family, who has a big secret. And in The Ballad of Jack and Rose, Daniel Day-Lewis plays a fatally ill man struggling to control the sexual urges of his teenage daughter.
Welcome to the Central Park Zoo.
But what will there be for kids? Well, not to worry. In Madagascar, four animals from New York's Central Park Zoo are unexpectedly shipped to Africa.
The sky is falling!
Take cover!
For more talking animals, there's Chicken Little. It's a modern take on the bird who insisted the sky was falling down.
There's a good dog.
and Wallace and Gromit, the much-loved duo from Nick Park's Clay animated shorts, will get an entire feature-length movie this year.
Breakthrough, lad.
These films are just a taste of what's to come in 2005. Some of it you might like, and some of it you might prefer to ignore.
We'll just pretend for you.
The Assassination of Richard Nixon is the title of a picture that won't be to everyone's taste. It stars Sean Penn, portraying an American everyman, a real-life salesman who hatched a plan to assassinate the 37th President of the United States. Laura Metzger reports.
Testing, testing, testing.
February 22nd, 1974.
Take number one.
Sam Beck's life is unraveling. His wife has left him, his boss demeans him, and his friends tolerate him. Bick thinks the American dream has failed him, so he decides to assassinate President Richard Nixon.
You want to know who the greatest salesman in the world is? That man right there. Right there.
I've always thought that the film has a level of social commentary, but at the same time, I think that it's a very small film. It's about a guy who wants his wife and kids back. And it starts with the political scene of 1973, 1974 America as a backdrop, and then over the course of the film he develops a relationship with Nixon on television, who ultimately becomes his target.
Somebody has to resist.
It's a story that's based on actual events, and first-time director Niels Mueller says he wanted to explore what drives a man to commit an act of violence. In this film, that act is Bick's attempt to hijack a commercial airplane and crash it into the White House.
It was really something that I personally was tremendously interested in understanding, is again, how does somebody go from point A to point B? And with point B being where this person loses all empathy and lashes out in violence. So we chose to start the film with at least a few fingers still on the ledge, you know, that he can pull himself back up.
Okay, Mrs. Anderson, where is Marie?
For me, the kind of films that I love watching and have always enjoyed watching, that I'm drawn to myself, are films where I feel like I'm a fly on the wall and that I enter a world I otherwise wouldn't get a chance to enter.
Come on, you guys, dinner's ready.
Daddy, take me a picture.
See you next Sunday, Sam.
It seems Sean Penn was equally drawn to the material. After being sent the script in 1999, he signed on and stuck with the first-time director for years as he dealt with difficulties financing the film in a post-9/11 world that wasn't eager to see a movie depict an act of terrorism on a plane.
There were different kinds of no's that we got from potential financiers after 9/11. There was one particular company that said, loved the script up until that ending, would never make a film with that ending after 9/11. And I had another company say, we can't make the film with that ending. Can you change the mode of assassination attempt? And I said, I could have changed it before 9/11, but you can't change it after 9/11 because it's based on truth. That you have to go toward the truth and relevance of the story if you're going to make it in post 9/11 America.
Power is a state of mind.
The clips handed out to promote this film don't show the scene that bears some resemblance to what happened on September 11th. It's a horrific act of terrorism that audiences may consider in extremely bad taste. But Mueller feels the violence is justified for artistic reasons.
Without showing that violence, which in a case like this isn't at all gratuitous, because you've had an audience that many people will identify with this character, to not show the horror that this character perpetrates in a very random way, which is how it unfolded, then I would have felt like I was being irresponsible as a filmmaker.
I'm not the man in the Cadillac. That's not me.
Irresponsible or not, the film will be seen as political because it depicts events from Nixon's administration that some may compare to the situation that exists now in contemporary America.
See what I'm saying? You gotta believe.
You have images in this film of bombs dropping, and you take away the foliage, i.e. the foliage of Vietnam, and you have images that are current. You have a polarized public, and you have people who are deeply distrusting of an administration and other people, because there are plenty of people who give a leader the benefit of the doubt for as long as possible. So it's unavoidable to look at some of the parallels, but that said, that's all after the film was written, so that's just, you know, happenstance, but you know, people take what they will.
They will never forget me. Not ever. I was here.
Imelda Staunton is winning accolades by the minute for her role as a backstreet abortionist in London in the 1950s in The Vera Drake. The excellence of her portrayal is due to her own formidable talents, but the film's director, Mike Lee, also deserves a lot of credit. Today we shine the spotlight on a man who's made what could be the best film of his career.
Hello, George. Oh, hello, Peggy.
Vera Drake was launched at the Venice Film Festival, where it won the top award. It's the story of a working-class abortionist who believes she is doing good. It shows a parallel upper-middle-class world where women have an easier time getting a pregnancy terminated. But this is not a film about abortion. It's more a portrait of a compelling woman with values totally decent to her, shocking to others, that she hides from those closest to her.
I put her right, set her mind at rest.
You always do, don't you?
Many are singling out Lee's film, saying it's better than anything he's done in the past. Does he agree?
No, I don't. I mean, it may be, but I don't think it is. I think that's, you know, I don't think it is. I think it may be different in some ways, but, you know, it's another movie, it's another go, another bite of the cherry, you know.
You say that, but a lot of people say that it is one of the best films that you've made. What is it you think that they're latching onto? Is it more accessible?
I don't think it's more accessible, but certainly it's obviously at the core of it are issues that people absolutely relate to. I mean, it may well be that, you know, it just so happens that there's a certain kind of chemistry in the film where we just kind of, everything just clicked together and we somehow got it right. I don't know.
What's all this about?
Vera Drake is very, very good. It's brought forth superlatives and bold pronouncements. At a recent awards event, Lee was described as a director at the peak of his career.
Is that accurate? Have you peaked?
Well, I mean, it's a slightly terrifying prospect, because if this is the peak, I don't want to contemplate what happens next, really. So I'm not altogether, I mean, I take the implied flattery of that statement, but I don't care for the longer-term implication.
Would you ever work as a director for hire?
No. Never.
Why is that?
Why should I? I mean, I've got a job to do, and that's making my sort of films on my terms. And being a director for hire is something that I think will be a waste of time. I mean, time that's better spent on doing my proper job.
Do you regard it then as a privilege that you've been able to do that in Britain, to be a filmmaker and to make films on your own terms?
It's a huge privilege. It really is. I mean, I've been exceptionally lucky, particularly considering that I'm the guy with no script. I won't discuss casting and has final cut. I've been amazingly lucky. I've made 17 full-length films with no interference from anybody. And I think that's lucky, very.
Whatever you think of Lee's work, an article recently described him as a melancholic realist, his films reflect his own voice. That's rare in cinema nowadays, where corporate control, greed, or a desire to please others render many directors unable to produce anything other than shallow results.
Cut. Cut it. Reset.
Director Nicole Castle has startled many in the business by the strength of The Woodsman, her very first feature film. Laura Metzger has been taking stock of Castle, who's become a much sought-after talent.
Nicole Castle was still a student in film school when she saw a stage production of The Woodsman. She was drawn to its portrait of a child molester, so she decided to adapt the play for cinema.
For me, it really was witnessing a character that we so often perceive as one-dimensional, black and white, good, evil, and realizing that he was a human being. And it was personally finding myself changed when I left that theater. You know, I felt like a different person, and that was a very important story to tell on a journey I hoped that more people would go through.
Highlighting the human side of one of society's more reviled figures was seen as a bold choice for a first-time director to tackle.
So if you ever touch my daughter, I'll kill you.
Did you have any reservations about taking on such contentious material for your first feature film? I had moments of, why am I stacking every odd against myself I can? You know, I just raised the stakes. But I was so passionate about it, and getting your first film made is so hard anyways. I figured, let me just, you know, I have to care this deeply about it.
Are you more drawn to stories that reflect a certain social reality as opposed to, you know, directing a happy fantasy?
I think for me the most important thing is I do want to make movies that leave people thinking, but I also wanted to play in different genres. The next film I'm making is a dark comedy. You know, I love all different kinds of films, and if it leaves you with something to walk out of the theater with, then it's a worthwhile film for me to make.
But Castle making this film wasn't a foregone conclusion. Lee Daniels, the producer behind 2001's Monsters Ball, reportedly wanted someone with more experience behind the camera. But Castle wouldn't sell her script without a deal to direct. Daniels agreed, and among other things, he says her gender was an asset.
If we had heard it from a male's perspective, or seen it from a male's perspective, it would have been a different, she brings a touch to it that a man doesn't understand.
Some might find Daniels' perspective refreshing, especially in an industry where female directors are in short supply.
You know, female directors in this business are a bit of a rarity. Did you ever feel that the fact that you're a woman, that it was a liability? I didn't. You know, and if it had been, I don't know that. I don't know why I got rejected by the people I did. But, you know, I have to say, since The Woodsman's come out, I've only had open doors in terms of meetings and project submissions, and so to me it feels very open. You know, I'm very grateful to people that, the women that broke that wall down, you know, for me.
With awards and high praise coming Castle's way for The Woodsman, her future looks bright. Next up, she'll work with Michael Douglas on an adaptation of Arthur Miller's play, The Ride Down Mount Morgan. From there, it's anyone's guess, and even Castle is undecided if a career in Hollywood is calling.
Maybe, maybe not. You know, the careers I really emulate are like Stephen Frears and Gus Van Sant, who, even Steven Soderbergh, they really go back and forth between, you know, mainstream Hollywood and then more intimate films that are personal to them. And I would love to be able to walk back and forth like that.
I'm not a monster.
A love song for Bobby Long features the city of New Orleans and John Travolta. The one-time star of Saturday Night Fever looks quite different from his other screen incarnations in this film. Today we focus on the woman who directed John Travolta in this production.
Shaney Gable shot a love song for Bobby Long on location in New Orleans. Travolta plays a retired literary professor who lives in a rundown house. Also in residence is his protege of sorts. It's the story of what happens when a young woman, portrayed by Scarlett Johansson, arrives on the scene. The house belonged to her mother, who's recently died. Relations between the three become quite intense.
Come see what Percy did.
See what she didn't do. Leave.
She ain't gonna leave.
Bohemian individuals invested in literature, living somewhat on the margins in New Orleans, are strong elements in the film's screenplay.
It's the depth of the writing and the literary references suit the scenario so beautifully and brilliantly that it's hard not to be attractive to an actor.